Bardzo serdecznie dziękuję panu profesorowi Szewczykowi, wiceprezesowi naszego towarzystwa, za prowadzenie techniczne tego naszego dzisiejszego spotkania. Szanowni Państwo, witam bardzo serdecznie wszystkie osoby, które zechciały przyjąć nasze zaproszenie na odbywaną zdalnie galę parnasowską, która upamiętni laureatów corocznych nagród Polskiego Towarzystwa Biochemicznego. Te gale odbywają się w latach, kiedy nie są organizowane zjazdy Polskiego Towarzystwa Biochemicznego, które od kilku lat mają formułę kongresów bio. Zaproszenie na dzisiejszą galę zostało wystosowane do wszystkich członków naszego towarzystwa. Witam wszystkich Państwa bardzo serdecznie. Szczególnie serdecznie witam tych z Państwa, którzy dzisiaj będą wymienione jako laureaci nagród naszego towarzystwa. Najważniejszą, Szanowni Państwo, nagrodą naszego towarzystwa jest nagroda Jakuba Karola Parnasa. Ale zanim do tej nagrody przejdziemy, wymienimy inne nagrody, które również co roku przyznaje nasze towarzystwo. Nagrodę imienia Bolesława Skarżyńskiego za najlepszy artykuł w kwartalniku Postępy Biochemii w roku 2020 przyznana została za artykuł Bogaty świat ryboprzełączników doktorowi Piotrowi Machtelowi z Instytutu Chemii Bioorganicznej. Nagrodę imienia Bronisława Filipowicza za popularyzację biochemii oraz nauk pokrewnych przyznaliśmy doktor habilitowanej Małgorzacie Iciek z Kolegium Medicum Uniwersytetu Jagiellońskiego za działalność promującą nowe kierunki nauk o życiu w związku z 44. Kongresem FEPS w Krakowie, w którym pełniła pani Małgosia funkcję sekretarza Komitetu Organizacyjnego. Nagroda imieniem Witolda Drabikowskiego za najlepszą pracę doktorską z biochemii została przyznana oraz z tą nagrodą połączona jest nagroda firmy Merck. Przyznana została w tym roku dr Paulinie Wigner za rozprawę Rola stresu oksydacyjnego i nilacyjnego oraz szlaku katabolitów tryptofanu w patogenezie depresji. Promotorem tej rozprawy doktorskiej był profesor Tomasz Śliwiński z Wydziału Biologii i Ochrony Środowiska Uniwersytetu Łódzkiego. Oprócz tej nagrody komisja postanowiła przyznać dwa równorzędne wyróżnienia za najlepszą pracę doktorską z biochemii. Doktor Annie Cortis za analizę funkcjonalną białka C6ORF203 nowego czynnika zaangażowanego w metabolizm RNA w mitochondriach człowieka, której promotorem był profesor Roman Szczęsny z Instytutu Biochemii i Biofizyki w Warszawie oraz dr Karolinie Pierzynowskiej za rozprawę indukcja autofagii jako mechanizm działania genisteiny w eksperymentalnej terapii chorób neurodegeneracyjnych. Promotorem tej rozprawy był profesor Grzegorz Węgrzyn z Wydziału Biologii Uniwersytetu Gdańskiego. Wszystkim wymienionym laureatom naszych nagród składam bardzo serdeczne gratulacje. Przejdę teraz do nagrody Parnasa. jest to najważniejsza nagroda naszego towarzystwa. Ale zanim opowiem o tej nagrodzie i tegorocznej laureatce, chciałbym krótko przypomnieć, kim był Jakub Karol Parnas. Nasi przyjaciele, zwłaszcza z młodszych generacji, mogą nie wszystko o tym wybitnym uczonym wiedzieć. Otóż Jakub Parnas uważany jest za jednego z najważniejszych twórców polskiej biochemii. Przed wojną stworzył we Lwowie wybitną szkołę badawczą, która dokonała szereg odkryć nad reakcjami utleniania beztlenowego. Stąd glikolizę nazywa się często szlakiem Embdena Meyerhofa Parnasa. Po wojnie jego uczniowie kierowali katedrami biochemii w kilku ośrodkach akademickich naszego kraju. I tak, we Wrocławiu Tadeusz Baranowski, Wanda Maybaum, Katzen Ellenbogen, w Warszawie Józef Heller, Irena Mochnacka, Zofia Zielińska, w Gdańsku Włodzimierz Mozołowski, w Lublinie Janina Opieńska-Blaut. Spośród żyjących przedstawicieli tej szkoły Państwo zapewne znacie dwoje zasłużonych członków naszego towarzystwa, profesor Jolantę Barańską i profesora Andrzeja Dżugaja. O samej nagrodzie. Według statutu naszego towarzystwa nagroda Parnasa obejmuje trzy elementy. Nagrodę rzeczową, dyplom honorowy oraz przywilej wykładu publicznego. Tak, proszę Państwa, przywilej. Mówienie do członków towarzystw przyrodniczych jest bez wątpienia przywilejem. Otóż nagrodę rzeczową od szeregu lat funduje dr Piotr Chomczyński, członek honorowy naszego towarzystwa, mieszkający stale w Stanach Zjednoczonych. Jest ona dzielona pomiędzy współautorów według podziału zaproponowanego przez autora korespondencyjnego wyróżnionej pracy. W tym roku nagrodę Jakuba Karola Parnasa za rok 2020 otrzymuje zespół za publikację w EMBO Reports za pracę pod tytułem Mitochondrial Protein Biogenesis in the Synapse is Supported by Local Translation. Autorem korespondencyjnym tej pracy jest doktor habilitowana Magdalena Dziembowska, którą raz jeszcze serdecznie witam. Współautorami tej pracy jest 12 badaczy, których wymienię w kolejności, w której są przedstawieni w tej publikacji. Bożena Kuźniewska, Dominik Cysewski, Michał Wasilewski, Paulina Sakowska, Jacek Miłek, Tomasz Kuliński, Maciej Winiarski, Paweł Kozielewicz, Ewelina Knapska, Michał Dadles, Agnieszka Chacińska, Andrzej Dziembowski, Magdalena Dziembowska jako autorka korespondencyjna. O samej referentce i wykładowczyni dzisiejszej prezentacji. Pani doktor habilitowana Magdalena Dziembowska pracuje w Centrum Nowych Technologii Uniwersytetu Warszawskiego, gdzie wraz ze swoim zespołem prowadzi badania nad plastycznością synapsów związaną z identyfikacją rodzajów mRNA, kodujących białka w odpowiedzi na swoiste bodźce zewnętrzne. Stopnie naukowe doktora i doktora habilitowanego uzyskała w Instytucie Nęckiego. Odbyła staże doktorskie długoterminowe w Paryżu, w Instytucie Pastera oraz Instytucie Curie. Tytuł dzisiejszego wykładu: Mitochondrial protein biogenesis in the synapse is supported by local translation. Wykład będzie w języku angielskim. Dla informacji Państwa przekazuję, że zgodnie z tradycją tych wykładów po wykładzie nie odbędzie się dyskusja, natomiast można zawsze do autorki zwracać się drogą korespondencyjną lub jakąkolwiek inną. Bardzo dziękuję Państwu za uwagę. Zapraszam panią profesor Dziembowską. Bardzo proszę, pani Magdo.
Dziękuję bardzo za to miłe wprowadzenie. Dzień dobry Państwu. No, chciałam zacząć oczywiście od podziękowań. Jest nam niezwykle miło. Czujemy się zaszczyceni. Jest to honor wielki dla mnie i wszystkich moich współpracowników i członków mojego zespołu również. Ta praca powstała dzięki współpracy wielu zespołów, głównie tutaj z kampusu Ochota w Warszawie. Tak jak pan profesor wymienił osoby, ja może wymienię instytucje, w związku z tym współpracowaliśmy z profesorem Eweliną Knapską z Instytutu Nęckiego, który tutaj widzę przez okno właśnie, z Instytutem Biochemii i Biofizyki, gdzie pracuje profesor Dadles i Andrzej Dziembowski, z którymi robiliśmy protomikę i transkryptomikę. No i oczywiście z Międzynarodowym Instytutem Biologii Molekularnej i Komórkowej, gdzie w Onegdaj, wtedy kiedy powstawała ta praca, pracowała profesor Agnieszka Chacińska, która następnie przeniosła się tutaj do Centrum Nowych Technologii Uniwersytetu Warszawskiego, co nam znacznie ułatwiło współpracę i robienie wspólnych doświadczeń. Czujemy się w tym roku niezwykle docenieni, dlatego że jest to już druga nagroda, którą otrzymujemy za tą publikację. Pierwsza nagroda imienia Jerzego Konorskiego to była nagroda za najlepszą pracę neurobiologiczną z polskimi autorami. Także ja muszę powiedzieć, że teraz mówiąc o sobie, że jestem neurobiologiem molekularnym, czuję się znacznie pewniej, ponieważ wiem, że taki dyscypliny właściwie nie ma, ale po otrzymaniu tych dwóch nagród myślę, że już mogę spokojnie tak się mienić. Postaram się teraz, tak skorzystam z przywileju wygłoszenia referatu i opowiedzenia Państwu, o czym jest ta praca, o czym są nasze wyniki. Zobaczymy, jak ten screen share się uda. Że widać prezentację. I will switch into English. So I would like to start by introducing to you the two first co-authors of this paper that was published in Embo Reports, entitled Mitochondrial Protein Biogenesis in the Synapse is Supported by Local Translation. And these two people are Bożenka Kuźniewska from Center of New Technologies, from my laboratory, and Dominik Cesarski, who works in the Institute of Biochemistry and Biophysics. And he's an expert in proteomics, and I'm sure that many of you know him very well. Okay, so I'm a neurobiologist, and as all neurobiologists, I am mostly interested in how the brain works. And just trying to put it in a place which is less annoying and more comfortable. Okay. So So I am mostly interested in the molecular processes that take place at the synapse. So synapses, for me, are the most basic units of neuronal networks. And this is what makes them really interesting, you know, to study, because they connect neurons together, and then by enabling synaptic transmission, they can modulate the whole neuronal networks, which are very, very complicated in the brain, and they interconnect not only neurons, but also the structures in the whole brain. So synapses are located in the neurons on so-called dendritic spines. And these are also the very simple protrusions that you can observe when you look at under the microscope and you look at the neuron. You can see that they look like a brush a little bit. And on the top each of such dendritic spines, there is a synapse located. And this makes it somehow independent compartment of the cells, because it has its own structure that can be really changed very fast, for example, after the synaptic stimulation. And these are the most simple or also units that will allow the transmission of this signal in the synapse. So the synapse has the presynaptic side of the synapse, of course, from which the neurotransmitter are released, and then they will act on the specific receptors that are localized on the postsynaptic side of the synapse. So we have a presynaptic compartment and postsynaptic compartment. This is how we call them. And as I said, these synapses are semi-independent compartments in the cells, because they have their own protein synthesis. They have their own machinery that enables the local synthesis of the proteins on basis of mRNAs that are, of course, synthesized in the cell nuclei and then transported along the dendrites, long distances sometimes. And then they can be activated upon the stimulation, and then they can be locally translated. And here is an example of such an activation. So we have a synapse from its pre and postsynaptic side. And let's say that the stimulation comes and the neurotransmitters are released from the presynaptic side. And then the impulse is so important that the cell decides that the expression of new genes will be induced in the nucleus. But this, of course, will take time. And we used to say that it's at least 20 minutes from the induction of the signal to the transcription is to the moment when the transcription is induced. And in this time, the synapse naturally grows and stabilizes and incorporates more receptors into its postsynaptic compartment. And this is all because there is a pool, this is all possible because there is a pool of mRNAs that are present in this synapse that can be translated locally at the synapse, and then they can build this, can enable the enlargement of the postsynaptic compartment, and they can wait until this newly transcribed mRNAs will be transported again to the synapse, and this stimulation is sustained for a long time. So this is the model of LTP, long-term potentiation, that I was talking about. And actually, for the last maybe 20 years, many of these mRNAs were discovered. And we know that most of them are important for the physiology of the synapse. And they would be like the receptors or the proteins that encode postsynaptic density. And others, but many of these locally translated proteins are still unknown. So So when I started my laboratory, I was very much interested in identification of synaptic proteome. And so we decided to study what are the proteins that are locally translated in synapses in response to the specific type of synaptic stimulation. And to do this, we decided to use the model that is called synaptoneurosomes, and I will tell you a little bit more about it in a minute. But we wanted to isolate those proteins that were locally synthesized, and we used proteomics to do this. But we also wanted to study those mRNAs that were present in the synapses, and they were bound to the ribosomes or polyribosomes, to actually be sure that we are studying an ongoing translation. So the process, which is when the mRNA is bound to the ribosomes, especially when there are many ribosomes or polyribosomes are formed, we are sure that the translation of this mRNA is ongoing. So we wanted to identify the proteins that are locally translated in the synapse in response to synaptic stimulation. So the model that we are working on are so-called synaptoneurosomes. So this is the fraction of brain homogenates obtained by the series of filtration and homogenization from, and it's freshly prepared from the mouse or rat brain. It contains both pre- and post-synaptic site of the synapse. Actually, this is just the fraction is enriched in the synapses containing both pre- and post-synaptic proteins. So we can say that by looking at the Western blots, we have the whole brain homogenates on the left and the synaptoneurosomes on the right. And you can see that, for example, PSD95, the common post-synaptic density protein is highly enriched, but also the receptors for the glutamate or neuroleukin 3, which is also a very important protein. We also observe the presence of GFAP, which would mean that there are glial cells present in these preparations as well. But what is important about this the synaptoneurosomes is that we can stimulate them in vitro. So as I said, they are freshly prepared from the brain. And you can, for example, add radioactive amino acid like methionine or cysteine and incorporate the, and this radioactive amino acid will be, of course, incorporated into the newly synthesized proteins in synaptoneurosomes. So we did this and we stimulated synaptoneurosomes with the NMDA, and we induced so-called NMDA receptor stimulation. And to be sure that this is truly the synaptic NMDA receptor that was induced, we did the we looked at the phosphorylation of the kinase of ERK, because only the transient phosphorylation of this kinase, like 1 minute after the NMDA receptor stimulation, would mean that this was the proper stimulation of the synaptic receptors. Otherwise, if this ERK phosphorylation is prolonged, it can induce the toxicity, the cytotoxicity of it wouldn't be good for our experiment. So we did all the controls here. And actually what we observed with time on the Western, but on the SDS page, is the incorporation of this radioactive methionine into the proteins that are resolved on this gel. So you can see that this is the 15 minutes, 30, 1 hour, and even 2 hours after the stimulation, there is an increase in radioactivity in the proteins that were synthesized in these vesicles that were freshly isolated from mouse brains. So the control here was a pure myosin, which is an inhibitor of protein synthesis, and this was nicely inhibited this induction of local protein synthesis inside actinomyosomes was inhibited by the furomycin, but not by chloramphenicol, that inhibits only the synthesis of the protein in mitochondria. So now, having established this nice model, we wanted to compare the synaptic proteinome of untranslated of unstimulated and stimulated synaptomyosomes. And for this, we used quantitative proteomics. So we had like totally unstimulated synaptomyosomes and the ones stimulated with NMDA to induce the NMDA receptor signal in synaptomyosomes. As I said, we did the quantitative mass spectrometry based on isobaric labeling. So for this part of experiment, Dominik Cisewski was responsible. And of course, on the very beginning, we wanted to look on synaptic proteins. We were very interested in which proteins that are important for the synapse physiology will be enriched after the stimulation. But when we did the annotation enrichment analysis, it appeared that the second group of proteins were mitochondrial proteins actually. So, we thought maybe it is important, maybe truly mitochondrial proteins are induced in this, model system, but we also, of course, looked at the transcriptome. So as I said, we wanted to visualize these mRNAs that were in synaptomyosomes bound with ribosomes or so polyribosomes. So we performed the fractionation of polyribosomes of sucrose gradients. We isolated the mRNAs from these polyribosomes. We compared, so this is just profile of on the sucrose gradient, and this is the mRNA. So we see that there is a stimulation after the induction of the signaling of NMDA receptor. There is more mRNA bound to polyribosomes. So we sequenced these mRNAs that were stimulated, and we compared them with a pool of unstimulated, total unstimulated synaptomyosomes, mRNAs. And then we realized that the transcript encoding all upregulated proteins that are here in the green dots and mitochondrial proteins that are in orange dots, they were detected by mass spectrometry, and they represented a highly abundant mRNAs with good ribosome association values. And actually, all of those proteins that we found to be enriched after the stimulation, and we found them to be mitochondrial, were present as mRNAs on the polyribosomes. So we were quite sure by having these results that mitochondrial mRNAs are important, are translated, and are a big pool, a big amount of those proteins that are locally synthesized in synapses. So actually, in percentage, that was 13% of all upregulated proteins were mitochondrial, and actually 20% of all identified proteins were mitochondrial. So a large number. So When I think about it now, it doesn't seem so surprising, because of course, when you look into the brain using, for example, electron microscopy, the first thing that we will notice and spot are mitochondria. There is plenty of mitochondria, the neurons are filled with mitochondria. And this is because, of course, they have high energetic demands on the ATP, on the energy that is produced by the mitochondria, because these are highly energetic cells. And we of course, realize, everybody knows, it's a common knowledge, that the brain is consuming a lot of energy, right? So here is an example where we see the presynapse with the mitochondrium inside, with these are the synaptic vesicles, and the postsynapse with a very nice small round mitochondrial egg. So this was when we started the collaboration with Professor Agnieszka Hacińska, who is an expert in mitochondrial biology. So we went to her with these results and said, well, we hope you can help us to study the mitochondria in synapses, and this is what happened. And actually, first thing that we wanted to measure was the respiration, the respiratory rates of the mitochondria that were in synaptic neurosomes in our preparations. And Michał Wasilewski from Agnieszka Hacińska lab did this Ouroboros oxygraphy. And he measured the respiration of synaptic neurosomes and compared it to the respiration of Hex cells. And as you can see, there is a very similar respiratory rate of this mitochondria, and they react almost the same on all substrates and inhibitors. So we were sure that we have a functional mitochondria in the synaptic neurosomes that we can freshly isolate from the mouse brain. So of course, the big part of these proteins, when we looked at them, that we identified using mass spectrometry, were the proteins that were the respiratory complexes that were built in the big respiratory complexes in mitochondria. And the method to study this and to visualize this super large complexes in the gel is so-called blue native gel. So this is the method which allows you to resolve this big molecular wave. So this is, for example, about 700 kilodalton. And there is a specific pattern of these bands that represents a certain, and it's well established and it's known. And this represents the specific complexes of the respiratory chain of the mitochondria. And to be truly sure that what we are looking at here in this blue native gel are the mitochondrial complexes, we perform the West blood on these gels. The protein were transferred on the membrane and incubated with the antibodies that represented all the mitochondrial complexes, complex 1, 2, 3, 4, and complex 5, the ATPA synthetase. And as you can see, we compared these complexes in synaptic neurosomes and Hex cells again. And what was striking is that for example, for complex 3, we could observe so-called super complexes, which means that not only those single multi, of course, protein, big, large complexes were visible, but also them together with other complexes, which is a sign of this high respiratory potential of this mitochondria. So we even cut from the blue native these bands, and we sequenced them using mass spectrometry to show to the reviewers, of course, that we are truly observing the mitochondria in synaptic neurosomes. And this was all done to be able to perform this one important experiment that will show that these newly translated proteins that are, you know, synthetized in synaptic neurosomes, that they are incorporated into the mitochondria, actually transported inside the mitochondria, because the mitochondrial transport is the very complex and highly regulated biochemical process. And they are properly folded, and they are incorporated into this large macromolecular respiratory chain complexes. So how we did it? So first, we again incubated synaptic neurosomes with radioactive amino acids, with methionine, for 1 hour. And
Next, we run this blue native gel, very nice. You see unstimulated and stimulated synaptoneurosome. You can appreciate this nice pattern of mitochondrial complexes. But when we did the radiography, autoradiography on these gels, we could see that actually these radioactive proteins were truly incorporated in these complexes. And this was inhibited by uncoupling of the mitochondria with CCCP. Here, this is the Kumasi staining, and this is the autoradiography. And it was also inhibited by valinomycin, oligomycin, antimycin, the mixture of inhibitors that inhibit mitochondrial transport, but also with puromycin, which is an inhibitor of protein translation. And here again, we have the Kumasi staining of this blue native gel and the autoradiography. So what we were able to prove with this experiment is that these newly translated proteins in synaptoneurosomes are transported into the mitochondria and they form this large, they are enabled to be incorporated in this respiratory chain complexes. So this is how we sum up our discovery. A few months before our work came out, there was a paper in Cell saying that ATP, mitochondrial fuel, is important for local translation during synaptic plasticity. And we actually were able to show that this synaptic plasticity, which is supported by local protein translation, is producing mitochondrial proteins that can enter the mitochondria, that they can, where they build the active mitochondrial respiratory chain complexes, which enables the synthesis of ATP and the maintenance of synaptic plasticity. So so then we asked ourselves a question, of course, what would be the physiological role of such a process? So do we know a system in which the local protein synthesis is broken, dysregulated? And actually, yes, we do. We work on the mice that are called Fragile X syndrome mice, FMR1 knockout mice, in which the local protein synthesis is dysregulated. And this is due to the mutation in the FMR1 gene. So FMR1 gene encodes FMRP protein. And when it's one of these diseases in which there is a duplication of the CGG repeat, it's in the 5' uncodic region of this gene. And this when this CGG repeats is more than 200, then the whole region is inactivated by the methylation, and there is no expression of FMRP gene. And FMRP gene protein function actually is the inhibition of local protein synthesis. So normally FMRP binds to the mRNA, it's an mRNA binding protein, and it inhibits the movement of polyribosomes. So we say that it stalls polyribosomes, and only after the stimulation when it dissociates from this from the mRNA, certain FMRP regulated mRNAs can be translated. And when there is no FMRP, there is an excess of synaptic proteins. And some of them are very important, like AMPA receptors or neuroligins, neurexins, and many others were discovered. And this leads to abnormal synaptic plasticity and all this problems that we observe in the Fragile X syndrome. Also, very interestingly, these mice have this elongated dendritic spines. So they have this long, sometimes we say immature filopodial like spines, and they have immature synapses. So as I said, in this mice, the local synaptic protein synthesis is enhanced, including, of course, the mitochondrial proteins. So we wanted to see how this mitochondria look like, and we looked into the brain of these mice using electron microscopy. And we were very interested in observing this very small mitochondria that are located in the postsynaptic or presynaptic side of the synapse, because they are a little bit different from those large, big mitochondria that are in the cell body or axons and dendrites. So we looked at the wild type, as shown here, and FMRP, and we observed the a lot of these morphologies and, let's say, problems in this fragile X mice mitochondria. They were smaller in size, and also they accumulated very much of this osmophilic material here, but sometimes they were smaller, swollen as well. They have discontinuous membranes or fragmented, like here, for example. So they looked really unhealthy, and the crystal were disorganized. And especially when you compare it with Y-type mitochondria, which were very nice, pretty nicely organized and looking good and healthy. We also studied the respiratory rates in this synaptoneurosomes, and we could see that their respiration on complex 4 was changed, and they had like a higher respiratory rates. So this was also published in the paper, but this, of course, prompted us to study the mitochondria more, to really understand its role in the pathomechanism of autism-associated neurodevelopmental disorders, because Fragile X is such a disease. It has a high onset of autism. And I got a grant to study the mitochondria role, the mitochondria function in this neurodevelopmental disorders. And we are planning to analyze the proteomic of this non-synaptic and synaptic mitochondria, and to be able to compare it, but also all the biochemical parameters of mitochondria isolated from synaptoneurosomes and the whole brain extracts. And we plan to measure the respiration, of course, the ATP levels, production of reactive oxygen species, and the calcium buffering by neurons. This is planned in neurons in culture. And we also want to image the mitochondria in the living neurons in vivo, and to study their transport, their fission and fusion, because they can fuse and exchange their DNA, and also the ultrastructure of mitochondria in the brain. So this is the future, and I have only a few slides to show you another interesting mitochondrial gene that we studied recently in collaboration with Professor Rafa Płoski from Warsaw Medical University. And so actually he was able to detect a mutation in the patients which were identical twins, so two identically genetically identical boys, and one of them had autism and the other was perfectly healthy. And he found a mutation in the protein called TRAP1, which is this gene encodes the mitochondrial chaperone from HSP90 family. So this seemed really interesting to us as we started to work on mitochondria. This mutation introduced the stop codon in this almost on the end of this C-terminal domain of this protein. And TRAP1 is the protein that is involved in the response to the stress. It's so-called mitochondrial unfolded protein response. We created a mouse that is bearing this mutation, together with the Mouse Genomic and Genome Engineering Facility at the Biology Department of Warsaw University. And yeah, and we studied these mice. We started actually to study these mice. We don't see many differences. They have same, they don't have any harmful phenotype. They look normal. They have almost the same, similarly looking brains, let's say. But in the meantime, what was also very interesting, another family was found in which the mother was a carrier of the mutation and she gave it to her son, which also has autism. So in the case of family one, this was the novel mutation, heterozygotic, of course. And in case of family two, it was inherited from the mother. So then, coming back to the mice, we observed that in the mutants that carry two mutations, right, two alleles of the mutation, there is no expression of TRAP1 protein. There is less of expression in heterozygotes. This is, it's similar for the mRNA levels. They have very similar brains. No large differences were observed. This gene, this amino acid is highly conserved in the evolution, as we can see here. And so since we had these mice, we decided let's see if they have any autism-like behavioral features. And for this, we collaborated with Professor Ewelina Knapska again from the Nenski Institute. And she is having this great technology called EcoHub cages. It's a system of cages actually that provide measurements of spontaneous ecologically relevant behaviors in mice. So the mice live together in a cohort and they have the access to food, of course, and water ad libitum. And we have these four cages and we can observe where they are, how do they move in these cages all the time that they are in. So they are usually spent 4 days there and we can observe their general activity for males and females. They explore more on the beginning, but they, of course, they have more activity in the dark phase, less in the light phase. So, you know, they live in this cages and we observe them. And then after 3 days, we can expose them to so-called social odor and see if they will come and sniff this new social odor and see how do they respond to it. So what we were able to establish is that the females reacted differently than the males. Actually, this is in cohort sociability. So this is in cohort sociability. So I messed up a little bit. This is just their normal behavior. How do they like spending times together or not? And apparently, males were very much less social than the females. So the females for mutants, heterozygotes, and Y types didn't differ much. But for the males, we could see that there was a large difference and they were much less social. Let's say to the social distancing, they didn't want to stay together close to each other in one cage. And here is the results from the approach to social odor. When we put this odor of this bedding from the cage of unknown mouse, and we see how much they come and sniff it, because it's a new stimulation to them and they should be interested. And we could see that here the males didn't differ for heterozygotes, but did for mutants. And females were not interested, females mutant and males mutant were not interested in coming and sniffing this new sense, which makes them, the interpretation of this data would be that they are less social. So we also studied this, the differences in the dendritic spine shapes in this mice, separately for males and females. And also here, we could observe the differences between the sexes. So the males, for example, their dendritic spines were more dense and in females less dense. and females have longer spines and males shorter spines. So this is all very interesting. We can see differences that depends on the sex of these mice. And just to remind you that those mice, they have the mutation in the gene that is mitochondrial, that is responsible for the reaction to stress. And this is another let's say neurodevelopmental disorder that is that we will study in the future, the role of the mitochondria in it, not only in the fragile X. So thank you very much for your attention. This is my laboratory and the collaborators that I introduced already. Thank you very much.
Bardzo serdecznie dziękuję Pani Magdo za to niezwykle pięknie przedstawione badania, za ten wykład laureacki. Muszę powiedzieć, że bardzo się cieszę, że do archiwum naszego towarzystwa, do katalogu nagród Parnasa, bardzo się cieszę, że wpisuje się badania w tym roku tak kompleksowe, badania, w których w jednym obszarze spotykają się dociekania molekularne i fizjologiczne. To jest bowiem nieustanny cel wszystkich naszych badań przyrodniczych, poznać korelację między strukturą molekuł a funkcją biologiczną. Raz jeszcze, Pani Magdo, dziękuję.